Good morning, everyone. Good morning and welcome, everyone. I would say continue eating while I talk, as though you weren't going to continue eating anyway, so I won't say that. But thank you all for being here and at our 2017 Breakfast Series. I'm Larry Spencer, President of AFA, and it's really a pleasure to be here, and it's certainly a pleasure to see you all here today. On behalf of the Air Force Association, we really appreciate your participation. We value the opportunity to host our Air Force leaders, industry leaders, allied nations, and the media, so thank you all again for being here. I want to personally thank all of you for your continued support for the Air Force Association. Without our industry partners, members, and Air Force support, we would not be able to do what we do to promote a dominant Air Force. Your Air Force Association believes that we are all airmen for life. There's no such thing as leaving the Air Force. When you've been a part of the Air Force, it's part of your life. So with that in mind, if you're not already a member of the Air Force Association, we encourage you to join us. Please see one of our folks here, one of our staff folks. They'll be happy to sign you up, or feel free to visit our website at afa.org. We're also happy to, I hope you saw those on the way in, happy to offer you specialty items for sale. In particular, we have our Air Power Classics coffee table book available for purchase, and the author is here also to sign your personal copy. So please grab your copy on the way out if you don't already have one. It's also not too late to sponsor at AFA's Air Warfare Symposium in Orlando on the 1st through the 3rd of March at the Rosenkringle Hotel in Orlando. Again, more information can be found on our website, but I would encourage you all to attend. Those of you that attended our conference in September, you will notice, or you should have noticed, the growth that's there. We had more folks in our September conference than we've had in several years. It looks to be the same way in Orlando. So our conferences are growing, a lot more Air Force support, a lot more industry support. So please be there and join us. I think you'll really enjoy it. Obviously, if the nominated Secretary of the Air Force is confirmed, then she will be there as well. So we look forward to that if she's confirmed. We're also excited to celebrate the 70th anniversary of our Air Force. And our 70 for 70 campaign honors the 70th birthday of the United States by highlighting diverse heroes that make up our Air Force family, including those who have served past and present, families, community supporters, and anyone who has shown a commitment to make the Air Force great. Each month we will showcase previous or prior Air Force members and or families who have broken barriers through innovation, teamwork, and heritage. And today we're happy to announce our 70 for 70 recipient is Master Sergeant Dan Wassum. He is being honored for breaking barriers through his teamwork as a loadmaster evaluator. AFA plans to honor all recipients at our Air, Space, and Cyber Conference this September. So if any of you are here today want to sponsor this event, which is a really great event and a worthwhile event, please see us. We'll be happy to sign you up and happy to have you participate. So with that, the reason we're all here, we're honored to have with us this morning Lieutenant General John B. Cooper. General Cooper is the Deputy Chief of Staff for Logistics, Engineering, and Force Protection, Headquarters, United States Air Force, Washington, D.C., and the Pentagon. He is responsible to the Chief of Staff for Leadership, Management, and Integration of Air Force Logistics Readiness, Aircraft, Munitions, and Missile Maintenance of Civil Engineering and Security Forces, as well as setting policy and preparing budget estimates that reflect enhancements to productivity, combat readiness, and quality of life for Air Force people. Ladies and gentlemen, please join me in a warm welcome for a great AFA supporter, Lieutenant General John Cooper. Thanks, Pete.
Well, thank you, General Spencer. And good to see a lot of friends and family here and folks from the AFA. And I'm a proud member of the AFA, and I hope to see you in Florida in a couple weeks, or maybe, yeah, a couple weeks. We'll be down there. Look forward to that venue and continuing it. Thanks for this opportunity to chat with you. I'm excited about telling you about the A4. For a number of reasons. One, we got a lot of things going on in the A4, but another reason is I was at a similar event, not an AFA event, and somebody came up to me and said, yeah, we'd like to get you out and talk about what's going on in the A4. We're trying to get some of the smaller DCSs out and try to get the small ones involved in what's going on. And I said, yeah, I would like to do that, but I'd also like to tell you that even on the air staff, the A4 is one of the biggest DCSs in terms of manpower on there, and we pack quite a wallop in terms of fixing and supporting global vigilance, global reach, global power. So I'm out on kind of a campaign to inform as well as tell you all the good things we're doing, and then also kind of share with you things I think the AFA and industry and others could help with. So with that. The mission statement that we have for the A4 is we're the world's best at building, sustaining, and protecting the base. And when I say that, our Air Force is not going to go anywhere without the A4 people that comprise the A4. We're big business, so the A4. If you'd allow me just to describe the A4 for you briefly, because many people think I'm the maintenance guy, and I am a maintenance guy. I wear a maintenance badge, but we do a whole lot more than that. It's big business. We advocate for a $30 billion annual budget for all things logistics, munitions, engineering, MILCON, facility sustainment readiness, and force protection. So it's big business. My staff represents and manages the career fields for 262,000 airmen, total force airmen. So it's almost about half the total force active and reserve population. And then, if you look at what we're doing around the world, our Air Force is just everywhere. We got about 27,000 people deployed across the Air Force, and 10,000 of them are A4 people. So we're involved, we're engaged, and we just got so much going on. And I look forward to taking your questions. I have a couple prepared comments here, but I'm really looking forward to taking the questions. I'm going to focus my comments really on the logistics piece, the weapon system sustainment, manpower, and logistics piece. But certainly love to take questions, anything engineering, anything force protection. As we go forward, so if I were to give you a state of the Air Force A4, state of what's going on, I would categorize it in three major areas, and that's tempo, manpower, and aircraft condition. The tempo, many of you already know what's going on with our Air Force. You see it every day. We're deployed all over the world. And we're engaged everywhere in the supply chain management and providing the resources, protection, and engineering to across the Air Force. But we suffer the same maladies that everybody else would, and as many of you did before, some retirees in the audience, who have 27 years of combat operations, flying our airplanes, operating our space systems, and now introducing cyber and new systems for 27 years. So we have an entire generation up through colonel that know nothing but combat operations, and we're really the world's best. Now, when I grew up, it wasn't that way, right? I teach the wing commanders down, and I open up the senior leader maintenance course, mission generation course at Maxwell for the wing commanders every year, and I start out with a bunch of new stuff, and right in the center of it is a map, and I have blocked out all the words on the map, and I say, can anybody just tell me what that map is? And it's about six courses a year, and two of the courses people knew, a person knew, and four of the courses nobody knew. And I said, for the first 47 years of our Air Force, that's all we cared about. That's the fold a gap, children. And nobody, they just didn't know. And my point to them is, hey, we're heading back to the fold a gap, right? If you look at where we need to go, in the future, we need to concentrate, yes, on where we are in the area of responsibility, but we got a lot of engagement in the Pacific, a lot of engagement in Europe, and we got to focus our efforts on the new future and where we're heading. So, but we suffer those same maladies of deployment of aging aircraft and of budgets. Frankly, we've lost 38% of our end strength since Desert Storm. We're down about 38%. When we went into Desert Storm, we had 134 fighter squadrons. Now we have 55 fighter squadrons. We're as deployed really now as we have been ever in terms of percentage and where we're going. And in fact, we thought we'd be home in 2017. Which is good for the A4 people. We're, you know, the sustainers, like, we don't mind slowing down on tempo, but the tempo, in fact, is picking up. So we're expanding instead of contracting, and we're looking for new, and we continue to find new ways to support the operator on the front lines, and the front lines is an ever-expanding location of those front lines. We're in places not in the not only in the AOR, but theater security packages, both in the Pacific and in Europe, as well as engagements all over the place. So that's tempo. I think everybody here knows we're busy. Somebody called us we're busy as a one-armed paper hanger not that long ago. I like that. I wrote that one down. So our tempo is really, really something else. The second thing I want to, bring up is and share with you is our manpower. So we've been short maintenance manpower for a number of years now. I've been really the lead advocate in our air staff trying to generate the Air Force towards supplying more maintenance manpower so we can generate more air power, because the number one problem we have in our Air Force, in my opinion, is pilot production. We're short pilots. We need to get the pilots the sorties they need, particularly in the fighter business, the sorties they need so that they can be the world's best. I don't think we're giving them enough sorties. So we got a number of things working against us. One is manpower. I started this journey about 3.5 years ago. We were 4,000 maintainers short of what we needed. And that hole was growing by 40 maintainers every month because we were bringing in F-35s, and F-35 requires 20 maintainers each to maintain. We were bringing two per month in, so the hole was getting bigger. Well, our Air Force is committed to fix that. We recognize the problem. In fact, in 2016, without any budget enhancements or improvements or anything, our chief and secretary chose to move critical accession manpower from other very critical needs in our Air Force to maintenance. So we were able to shave that down. We're now 3,400 short maintainers, and we're planning it. We will get that number down to zero by about 2020, 2021, which I'm very happy about. But that's almost like squeezing the balloon. And what happens on the other end? Well, now we're going to have a lot of inexperienced workforce. So we're going to have many recently graduated high school students working on our fighter airplanes. And we take that very seriously, that we get them trained correctly so that they're trained and become experts eventually in fighting it. I was talking recently with the 82nd Training Wing Commander. That's at Shepherd Air Force Base, and Moon Daugherty. And Moon shared with me that last year he trained 2,400 maintainers, and this year he's training 4,800 maintainers. So about a 2x. In the training pipeline. So we're committed, but like I said, we're solving the quantity problem for manpower, but we're gonna have to work on the quality problem, and that's getting the experience for those manpower. Excuse me, I'm fighting a cold, so if I cough here, please pardon me. One area that we're also working to keep up with F-35 is we're so short on this manpower, this 3,500, and we're standing up units. We just stood uphill in IOC in 2016. Very proud of that as an Air Force. We still can't keep up with the quality. We can bring in a lot of accessions, but that's apprentice maintainers. We need quality, skilled maintainers. So we, in 2016, and then we began, and in 2017, we'll be manning five of our field training units with contract maintenance and harvesting that experienced maintainers and moving those towards the fighter airplanes that we need. And I'll get back to that in a little bit as I share some more thoughts with you about the contract aspect of that. So manpower, yes, we've solved it, or we're solving it, but we've solved the numbers issue. Now we've got to work on the quality issue. And we'll continue to juggle that issue around. As KC-46 comes up, we're looking not at the same problem, but we think we have a good plan for KC-46, but we have to stick with our plan. The third area that I'd like to discuss with you is aircraft condition. And I'll tell you, when we started this fight, 27 years ago, when we started our deployment, our 17 years ago, our airplanes were average 6 years. Now they're 27 years on average. And that, we hear that a lot, at least I hear that a lot. I don't know if you read that a lot when you're out and reading in the press or whatever. And that just kind of rolls off your tongue. It does, but it doesn't really tell. As the guy responsible for sustaining these airplanes, that doesn't tell the whole story in my mind. Any F-16 pilots in here? Former F-16 pilots? Okay, so former F-16 pilots. So I grew up in fighters and bombers. When I was a captain, we worked on F-16s in Europe. And we didn't even know the wings came off the airplane, right? If we ran a generation, we'd run out of pilots before we ran out of airplanes because the airplanes were so good that the pilot fatigue and, we'd use too many pilots, we had to stop flying. That was when I was a lieutenant. When I was a brigadier general running the depot at Hill Air Force Base, we began to explore taking the wings off the F-16s because of corrosion issues, and we had to understand how to get them off, and we did validation and verification to get the wings off, put them back on. Very complicated effort. Since then, we've changed 550 wings in the field for F-16s. It's just the nature of the business. The KC-135s, they set at the depot, just out of depot this week on Monday. The artisans out at Tinker Air Force Base, very proud of them. General Mark Johnson's running a really tight ship out there. They set their record. They completed program depot maintenance on the KC-135 for 71 aircraft last year. 90% of those airplanes had major structural damage when they took the skins off. So, and then they had to repair them. Right, 90%. And that's some people kind of raise their eyebrow and say, wow, that's kind of, are you sure you want to fly those airplanes? Well, we are the best. We're the world's best at sustaining airplanes. So those airplanes are very safe. We'll run those airplanes until the KC-46s are available for work. But my only point to you is when you're doing all that maintenance, the airplane's not flying. So we're not training our pilots. I was out at B-52s, and no kidding, the B-52 line on Monday, and the landing gear, if there's any B-52 pilots, seven miracles have to happen simultaneously to get those wheels back in the airplane, on this 1960s airplane. But the structure, the A-frame structure that holds the landing gear in place, they're up there with a buzzsaw, cutting it out because they're cracked and they got to replace the entire internal A-frame structure in the center of the B-52. It's just an amazing work. And it'll go right back in. And it'll fly, and we'll fly those airplanes. We're looking to get 90 to 100 years out of that airplane. Amazing. We're the world's best at sustaining airplanes. We're looking to get if our plan goes accordingly, we'll get about 30,000 hours out of our F-15Es, designed for 8,000 hours. And we'll do that through scientific research, detailed engineering, inspections, and repair and replace along the way. We're the world's best at it. But again, when that F-15 is in mod or that F-16 is getting the wing off, it's not flying, that pilot's not getting trained. So that's really a challenge for us, and one I want to just kind of throw out to the to you that, can we find better ways to maintain these airplanes? Is there a better way to predict the condition of the airplane? We have a pretty comprehensive flight structural fatigue program, but is there a better way? Is there some new technology that can help us? Is there some new repair processes? We're very interested in stuff like cold spray and stuff like 3D printing. I have a Twitter account. I don't really operate it too much. My exec does, but we just posted it on. I was at a Tinker, and the artisan's holding up a dashboard for B-1. That he 3D printed. They're going to install it on a B-1. That kind of stuff is we're lagging industry right now. We want to get up at either partner with or get ahead of industry as we look forward. So that's a big challenge for us. So when I look to the future, What am I looking at? So we got to find ways to increase aircraft availability to get those pilots the sorties they need. And we got to drive down budget too. So I was talking to a couple of folks here about the budget woes. So when you have a constrained budget like we do in our Air Force, the place you look is sustainment because it's big dollars. I said earlier we're about $30 billion annual. You can't avoid looking at a place like that to look for savings and so you can apply it against mission areas or other critical areas for our Air Force. So I'm challenged to continue keep that AA up, that aircraft availability up, and get the dollars down. So what have we done over the last few years? We've been teaming with industry, and I'd say we have some really we have some great examples of where industry and the Air Force come together to sustain an airplane. I mean, F-22, C-17, F-35, KC-46. KC-46 is a great example, I think, of how industry and the Air Force is combining efforts where we all know that we have strengths, core strengths. I believe that the Air Force part of our core strength is our touch labor. Another part of our core strength is like our organic supply. Industry's great at engineering, industry's great at supply. Can we get to some place where we can we get further than we are today? You know, at Depot we have, we use the Depot in the Air Force Sustainment Center, these vehicles called Captains of Industry contracts. And these Captains of Industry contracts are contracts that are kind of leveraged with industry to have a vehicle already established so you can rapidly, if you have a problem, like you got to cut a landing gear out of a B-52, you have the technical means to get a company to help you rapidly rather than waiting in 2 year of contract action to try to get that repaired. Where can we go? We use that similar, I referred to the maintenance for at the field level at the FTUs that we're manning. We used a similar contract vehicle to do that. That's why we were able to affect those hiring actions at the field level using contract maintenance really rapidly inside of a year. The only way we were able to do that is to have some type of leverage contract with industry already set up that we could use. So how can we get together? Is there other places we can get together? I mean, I challenge you to think about that. I mean, I've talked to a number of people even this morning about information technology, IT. IT in my world is a dinosaur. The 15 largest systems that operate our supply chain operate on COBOL. Does anybody know? You guys know what COBOL is. I know this crowd knows, but when I talk at home, you know, in the building, all the majors and lieutenant colonels need to go to the history books to see what COBOL is. So we got to change that, and we have a great plan to do that. We're working with industry on a number of issues. That's one area where, you know, formerly defense was leading that effort. Anymore, I mean, industry's leading that effort. Stuff on the shelf. You know, I've told my team, I don't care if it says afloat operations or in ashore operations or in garrison in a field, I'll take it and we'll use it unchanged because we don't need to change it to Air Force Base, or we'll just use ashore ops and say that means Air Force Base. You know what I'm saying? We don't need to change the IT that's already working. We're looking for that opportunity to do that. Where can we do? Is there other opportunities in services? We have plenty of services. A lot of our money is spent on services. Where can we partner with industry? That's where I spend a lot of my time thinking. I think I'll stop there and just share with you as I come down to take questions that as we look forward, we have a strategy that's built. I'd love to share it with anybody that's interested. I'm using words, and our tribe is using words like pre-supply instead of resupply. We see a future where, in a contested and denied environment, the tail is not the tail. Mr. Estevez used a great line, Alan Estevez, and I'm using it. Sustainment and logistics is not the tail; it's the jaw that enables the bite. If we're in a contested, denied environment, we're not going to be able to. We don't think we're going to be able to set up big bases forward, this Desert Storm and setting up those kind of things. That's just not the future. The future is going to be almost, I equate it to a two-minute drill. right? 2-minute drill. They have 3 plays already set. So, hey, go to that island. When you're done with that island, go to that country. When you're done with that country, go to that country. One day. And we're going to start moving supplies around to catch up with you. Pre-supply. How can we get there? A man can dream right now. I'm not going to get there on COBOL, I can tell you that. But a man can dream. And I think that with latest kind of technologies and innovation, we can make things happen. So I'll stop there, and I'll look forward to questions from the audience. Thank you.
Rizik, General Dynamics. I was wondering if you could share with us your thoughts on sort of the top 3 challenges we're facing with Air Force security forces, mm-hmm. particularly given with respect to high consequence assets. I'd be curious to get your views, sir.
I would say right now, Chattanooga, you know, when they say high consequence, I think airmen, okay, our people. But I'll get to other high consequence assets in a minute. Chattanooga, really, we don't even say it, we just say Chattanooga, and everybody on my staff understands that, you know, the Chattanooga attack about a year ago. We have been asked, our chief asked me to said, how do we figure out how to get to better protecting our airmen and their families? So we set up 3 programs on the base, basically set up a concept so an airman, can arm themselves with their personal weapon until they get to the office, the work site. And from there, at the work site, on the base, the government will make it more secure. So we enacted 3, or set up 3 programs. One was staff arming, so the defenders in a security forces building right now, the guy working in the armory is already armed, so there's a rapid response force already armed. They don't need to go issue weapons and so forth. I mean, they're ready to go. In addition to the people that are on patrol, that was one issue. Congress gave us legislation, I think 2008, called the Law Enforcement Officer Safety Act, which allowed credentialed defenders to carry concealed weapons on base. That was and the Air Force used it. We actually paid for our airmen to get the credential, but we didn't enforce it. We kicked that in after Chattanooga. Which was really good. And then we if you were to walk into an Air Force base, an office today, and you walk up, you know, the 3rd floor, you might see somebody sitting there doing their email armed, unit marshal program. So a blocking force. So if somebody comes into an office that's going to do something just stupid, a blue can shoot back and basically block until the force get there. So we did that. I'm very excited about emergency mass notification. I mean, you know, you see that child alert when a child, what do you call that? When the baby gets, Amber, thank you. Amber alert, you know, something like that. We challenge ourselves, like, can't we get an Amber alert type thing on cell phones? It was this funny, right? In the NCR, the Navy had a program, the Army had a program, the Air Force had a program, Marines had a program. That was available, but not everybody had it. So literally, if something happened on Bowling Air Force Base, I could be driving to the BX from my house, and all the sailors would be jumping in a ditch, and I'd be driving right into the fire. You know, we got that all fixed. So right now, any command post in the National Capital Region, any command post pushes a button, and every military gets notified immediately. I got notified last night. There was a bomb alert. Did you get it? A couple of airmen might have got it on their cell phone. Mass notification, very, very important. We're going to have the whole, before the end of this year, I think in the next 3 months, but well, I'll say by the end of the year, the whole Air Force will be set up regionally. So that, because right, even today, if you go to a base like, say, Hill Air Force Base, where you have AFMC and you have ACC, those are 2 different command posts. But they're the same Air Force. One person should push a button, everybody should get notified. That'll be done here within the next couple months. So we're excited about that, people. So that's the people thing. Technologies, I get concerned about the security of our assets because technology's kind of taken over. You know, you see it all the time. In fact, they had an article during the little expose during the presidential inauguration about how they're addressing unmanned aerial systems flying around. We're addressing that in the Air Force, both you know, everywhere we are. Very important to us and new. You know, most people would say, just shoot it down. Well, I think the FAA would tend to disagree. We're in the continental United States, so we have to worry about people's property. It could be unintentionally written. So we're working through all those rules now as a department to figure it out. I'd say that's the big one.
Yes, sir.
Hi, Scott Massioni with Federal News Radio. I was wondering, you talked about maintainers. How many right now are you putting under contract, and how much more expensive is that than actually having ones that are within the service?
I don't have a number for you. We're doing it at 6 bases. It's roughly a 1-for-1. It's actually a little less than 1-for-1 with the contractor, because what we've asked for is a service. Hey, make sure you can get X amount of sorties, and they man to what they need. So it could be more, could be less. I don't know. The dollar value is about equal. So we're going to take the airmen and we're going to replace it with money for contractors, but the dollar value is about equal. But I didn't say it in my comments, and I want to make sure you understand it's a short-term plan. So we only have that out for about, once we get the manpower solved in 19 or 20, we're going to bring the military back. And in fact, we kept the manpower bill, it's on the books, that we'll carry until we can get our inventory up.
Yes, sir. Mm-hmm. Hi, David Isby, Air International Magazine. We have the FY 2017 supplemental coming up and an accelerated review before the FY 2018 request goes in. What are you looking for in terms of additional resources for readiness and your responsibility areas?
Mm-hmm. In our previous budgets, we've taken a lot of risk in our installation. So we've taken our precious resources and we've applied them to mission needs. And we've taken risk in the base support area. So we have one of our supplementals. We have a number of supplemental initiatives. One of them is to increase the requirements for funds to secure to maintain our bases. But I will also tell you, I mean, we feel, if you just look at the number of airplanes, number of airmen, and number of bases, we don't need all the bases that we have. We have more infrastructure, more capacity than we need, so we can come down some, and we're willing to do that, and we're willing to study that. That's a big one. Stuff like supplies, transportation, funding, all that is being inserted into our unfunded priority, and it will compete with other needs.
Yes, sir.
Yeah, hi, James Drew from Aviation Week. Mm-hmm. With the contractor support for maintaining the F-35s, how does that compare to having to get these contractors to support these aircraft? How does that compare to legacy aircraft like the F-16 and F-15 when they rolled out? And also, how do you plan to get these contractors out to the front lines when these aircraft go into combat?
Mm-hmm.
And secondly, how are you going to protect forward bases like Guam and all your other Pacific bases against cruise missile and ICBM threats?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, thank you. So we're taking the active duty from the units and moving those active duty to F-35. So right now we're using contract in some locations, but they're training locations for F-35. But our intent is not to put contractors in combat units. So we're gonna put the contractors in training units. We're gonna move the active duty to the F-35 some other needs, but mostly F-35, so that when they deploy, the combatants will go forward with the airplane. I think that answers your question. And then the security in the Pacific, Guam was mentioned. There's a number of ways we're looking at further securing the island of Guam. But hey, technology's catching up, right? So even in Libya, when in Odyssey Dawn, so this was how many years ago is this? This was about 6 years ago. We were some number, I don't know the number, but we were like 50% precision, 50% not precision weapons. We're all precision weapons now, as is, and we expect that from our adversaries in the future. So a place like Guam, it eventually will become under the umbrella of an adversary's missiles. So what are we doing about it? Well, we're working for active and passive defense. We're looking for new technologies. There's lots of new technologies out there to help us. We're looking for part of my world is how to be more resilient, how to confuse the enemy, and we're taking many actions to do that as well.
Are there any promising technologies like lasers, microwave energy, or are you looking for defense agency to step up their support?
We're using all that. Anything's on the table for to protect our airmen, to protect American assets abroad.
Hi, Oriana Pollack with Military.com. I was wondering if you could talk a little bit more about munitions sharing between coalition partners in the fight against ISIL, and how we're working with precision-guided bombs, and how we mitigate how we share these munitions.
Sure. We have standing agreements with nations, and nations have standing agreements with us. If a nation were to ask for munitions, we'll ensure that we have them in quantity where we can afford to share them. We'll also borrow if we need to in that arrangement. It's a standing process. Does that answer your question?
I know there was a shortage, so has there been a ramp up of war, or how?
We've been dropping weapons quite proficiently for a while now, and we have no problem with our inventory. Okay, so we can continue the fight really indefinitely. We're working with industry now to ramp up their supply chains and their production to get us more right now. We manage it very well in the Air Force. It's centrally managed. It looks across the Air Force, looks across COCOMs to look for how do we get the assets to where they need for the fight that they're at. So I'd say we have no inventory problem, but we do recognize that our inventory is not where it wants to be. I mean, we want to grow, right? So it's incumbent on, I think the industrial base is not large enough. And I also think the department needs to transmit a commitment for a longer term effort, because we're going to be working our munitions inventories for quite a while.
Thank you. Chuck Wall, Deloitte. Can you talk a little bit about ALIS and how that's coming for the sustainment for the JSF, what the current status is, and how you see that fitting into helping you with reducing the cost of sustainment?
Sure. ALIS is coming along. You know, if ALIS was its own program, ALIS would be an ACAT-1 program. I mean, it's that large, so it's not really just the maintenance information system. So it's not just my world, but it really runs the F-35. It's had its burps in the past. It's really starting to get its legs underneath it and be supportive. One of the challenges that I find with ALIS is that it does not connect to the depot operations, and that's where all the supply chain starts. So the repair source for the supply chain is not connected through ALIS, and that bothers me. I think that should be. I don't know. So the F-35 sustainment is a contract, and I'm a vocal customer for the contract. So it is a contract moving towards a performance-based logistics contract, and I'm a customer. So I make my requirements known. I have made that requirement known, and we're working with the Joint Program Office to find a solution.
Mike, you had a question.
Thanks, sir.
Mike Basil with CACI. Thanks, General Cooper, for those great words and all the information here. You talked about aircraft availability. You talked about your sustainment challenges. You talked about the age of the force. From where I come from, cybersecurity is a big issue. And I know it's a threat to some of the aircraft, the systems on board, the support systems. It also adds an expense to something that is probably not in your budget. How are you guys dealing with that?
Thanks, Mike. That's a great question, because that's, I mean, I think we've elevated that. We're formally, I think, as not, it's not just the Air Force, in the department, really everywhere. Cyber was almost considered an admin. Cybersecure was kind of a, oh yeah, we have to fix cybersecure. No more. Cybersecure is front and center. We recognize that. You know, we've organized our Air Force with 25th and 24th Air Force to have a focused review on that. And we recognize that it's front and center, and we're putting our money where our mouth is. So I think our future budgets will show cybersecure integral, not maybe it won't be a separate add-on. It'll be integral into the programs that were cybersecure, which I think is very. I mean, I'm excited about that. But where we're finding all our problems is an usually an industry supported system that updates the OFP or the codes with a laptop that's in an insecure fashion. We got to get past that. So I'm a lot of the stuff we bought over the last 10 years is updated. I mean, munitions are up. Munitions, you plug your computer into the munition casket to update the munition. Those updates are taken off the worldwide internet, right? So it's not off a secure system necessarily. So what can we do as a team to help so that there's not an intrusion, an unintentional intrusion? I'm not suggesting that it comes from a contract, but it's just unintentional. How do we secure that piece of the business? Because they are out there, right? I mean, we see that regularly. I think that would help us.
Thanks. Chris, mm-hmm. You
Chris Jones, Northrop Grumman. Along those lines, if we think about trusted systems and resiliency in new systems, making sure, as you mentioned, they tie into the existing Air Force networks or driving down availability, there's always been a push to have more of that in the initial requirements and leading towards open system architecture, mm-hmm. so that way rapid upgrades can be made. And there's always been a struggle with getting that in requirements, so that would drive the contractors in the room to build that in versus expend more of the energy and time and really cost and mm-hmm. capability, and then you dealing with the tail aspect of that. Right. So I'd like to get your comments on how that's going, and is there things we can do here in industry on the sustainment logistics support side to support sure. that initiative?
Sure, thanks. Appreciate that, Dr. Jones. The yeah, there is some things that can go on. I mean, I'm pretty happy with where we're going with a couple of our new major weapon systems and the ones that are on the horizon, because we changed our way of thinking about 4 years ago, and it's actually starting to stick now. So we changed our policy 3-4 years ago, where we added sustainment into the early decisions for life cycle management or buying a weapon system. So KC-46 is a good example. The B-21 is going to be a good example. And the ones that we're competing now in there is driving down sustainment costs. Stuff like, I'll tell you, one-offs, don't, the Air Force does not like one-offs. So when I say one-offs, I'm not talking about sexy things like a radar for the airplane. I'm talking about inglorious things like test equipment. We spend a lot of money on test equipment, and I do not need another piece of test equipment for a new munitions to hang on an F-16 or an F-35. I need the same thing your company's building now, just modify it so it can work on that munition. I got way too much test equipment out there. I mean, this is where all the money is in weapon systems. Everybody knows, it's one-offs. It's a one-off on stuff like test equipment. It's one-offs on stuff like IT and management information systems. If a company has a management information system and we're doing business with the Air Force, what's most attractive to me, and I ask the question every time now, is why can't you use that system on this system and just change your ones and zeros to make it work? And we're getting, I mean, companies are listening, so that's good. But the one-offs is you can drive quite a bill on the sustainment side that really goes unseen until we're trying to sustain it down the road. Access to data is critical, and I think that I don't know that we need to own it. It depends on the PEO that's building the contract, But I know that we need to have access to it. We need to have the level of access that we need should we decide to compete it later on. And we form a business arrangement where everybody wins, and we're also able to not lock it in for 50 years. We're able to have to compete it and keep it keep that data. But you have to have access to the indicative data that drives the systems.
Thank you, General Cooper.
Yeah.
Bob Garcia with Raytheon. I was wondering if you could speak a little bit about the application of prognostics health management technologies and leveraging big data, machine learning, those kind of applications, and how that's impacting both legacy and new platforms.
We are leveraging that. I'm focusing on internal to the to logistics. I'm focused on logistics IT, certainly. I got to tell you, I feel like I got great support in the building. Our former undersecretary, now acting secretary, is championing logistics information technology. She sees that it needs to improve and go forward. So we've had a number of studies, and we have a new governance that's running it. Very excited about that. And we're leveraging things like, and I mentioned it on the podium, but if it's already built, we don't need something different. If it's working in industry, so we're looking at things like IT that's managing food chains. Can they manage our base supply? Okay, things like that. And where I would say formerly senior staff, senior officials in the Air Force didn't understand or recognize the way that new technologies work. And my vice chief of staff just sent me an article this morning, or yesterday morning, about how an IT system beat the three poker players in Texas Hold'em. I don't know, did anybody see that? It's a first application where a computer outthought humans. It's not a, or chess and checkers is a ABC game. You can program it. This was, you had to, in Texas Hold'em, you have to bluff, you have to hide. The computer is able to do that now, cognitively. He's saying, hey, Coop, I want some of that. Okay, boss, let me get off the COBOL, I'll get back with you. My point is, he's senior leader with vision saying go faster, and that's what we want to do. Cognitive is the way to, is the future.
All right, General Cooper, thank you so much for coming on. We really enjoyed your comments.
Yes, sir, appreciate thank you very much. Yes, sir.
I'd like to present you with a coveted,
wow,
very large.
That's a coin. Yeah. Thank you very much. Yes, sir, thank you.
Thank you all for being here. We really appreciate your attendance and your support of the Air Force Association. We look forward to the breakfast next month, so please stay tuned to your email as we announce the speaker. I'm told that the arm downstairs in the parking lot will be up, so you can get out very rapidly. So again, thank you so much for joining us, and we'll see you again next month. Thank you.
Good morning, everyone. Good morning, and welcome, everyone. I would say continue eating while I talk, as though you weren't going to continue eating anyway, so I won't say that. But thank you all for being here and at our 2017 Breakfast Series. I'm Larry Spencer, President of AFA, and it's really a pleasure to be here, and it's certainly a pleasure to see you all here today. On behalf of the Air Force Association, we really appreciate your participation. We value the opportunity to host our Air Force leaders, industry leaders, allied nations, and the media, so thank you all again for being here. I want to personally thank all of you for your continued support for the Air Force Association. Without our industry partners, members, and Air Force support, we would not be able to do what we do to promote a dominant Air Force. Your Air Force Association believes that we are all airmen for life. There's no such thing as leaving the Air Force. When you've been a part of the Air Force, it's part of your life. With that in mind, if you're not already a member of the Air Force Association, we encourage you to join us. Please see one of our folks here, one of our staff folks. They'll be happy to sign you up, or feel free to visit our website at afa.org. We're also happy to, I hope you saw those on the way in, happy to offer you specialty items for sale. In particular, we have our Air Power Classics coffee table book available for purchase. And the author is here also to sign your personal copy. So please grab your copy on the way out if you don't already have one. It's also not too late to sponsor at AFA's Air Warfare Symposium in Orlando on the 1st through the 3rd of March at the Rosenkringle Hotel in Orlando. Again, more information can be found on our website, but I would encourage you all to attend. Those of you that attended our conference in September, you will notice, or you should have noticed, the growth that's there. We had more folks in our September conference than we've had in several years. It looks to be the same way in Orlando. So our conferences are growing, a lot more Air Force support, a lot more industry support. So please be there and join us. I think you'll really, really enjoy it. Obviously, if the nominated Secretary of the Air Force is confirmed, then she will be there as well. So we look forward to that if she's confirmed. We're also excited to celebrate the 70th anniversary of our Air Force. And our 70 for 70 campaign honors the 70th birthday of the United States by highlighting diverse heroes that make up our Air Force family, including those who have served past and present, families, community supporters, and anyone who has shown a commitment to make the Air Force great. Each month we will showcase previous or prior Air Force members and or families who have broken barriers through innovation, teamwork, and heritage. And today we're happy to announce our 70 for 70 recipient is Master Sergeant Dan Wassum. He is being honored for breaking barriers through his teamwork as a Loadmaster Evaluator. AFA plans to honor all recipients at our Air, Space, and Cyber Conference this September. So if any of you are here today want to sponsor this event, which is a really great event and a worthwhile event, please see us. And we'll be happy to sign you up and happy to have you participate. So with that, the reason we're all here, we're honored to have with us this morning Lieutenant General John B. Cooper. General Cooper is the Deputy Chief of Staff for Logistics, Engineering, and Force Protection, Headquarters, United States Air Force, Washington, D.C., and the Pentagon. He is responsible to the Chief of Staff for Leadership, Management, and Integration of Air Force Logistics Readiness, Aircraft, Munitions, and Missile Maintenance of Civil Engineering and Security Forces, as well as setting policy and preparing budget estimates that reflect enhancements to productivity, combat readiness, and quality of life for Air Force people. Ladies and gentlemen, please join me in a warm welcome for a great AFA supporter, Lieutenant General John Cooper. Thanks, Coop.
Well, thank you, General Spencer, and good to see a lot of friends and family here and folks from the AFA, and I'm a proud member of the AFA, and I hope to see you in Florida in a couple weeks, or maybe, yeah, a couple weeks. We'll be down there. Look forward to that venue and continuing it. Thanks for this opportunity to chat with you. I'm excited about telling you about the A4 for a number of reasons. One, we got a lot of things going on in the A4, but another reason is I was at a similar event, not an AFA event, and somebody came up to me and said, "Yeah, we'd like to get you out and talk about what's going on in the A4. We're trying to get some of the smaller DCSs out and try to get the small ones involved in what's going on." And I said, "Yeah, I would like to do that, but I'd also like to tell you that even on the air staff, the A4 is one of the biggest DCSs in terms of manpower on there, and we pack quite a wallop in terms of fixing and supporting global vigilance, global reach, global power. So I'm out on kind of a campaign to inform as well as tell you all the good things we're doing, and then also kind of share with you things I think the AFA and industry and others could help with. So with that, the mission statement that we have for the A4 is we're the world's best at building, sustaining, and protecting the base. And when I say that, our Air Force is not going to go anywhere without the A4 people that comprise the A4. We're big business. So the A4, if you'd allow me just to describe the A4 for you briefly, because many people think I'm the maintenance guy. And I am a maintenance guy, I wear a maintenance badge, but we do a whole lot more than that. It's big business. We advocate for a $30 billion annual budget for all things logistics, munitions, engineering, MILCON, facility sustainment readiness, and force protection. So it's big business. We got, we represent, my staff represents and manages the career fields for 262,000 airmen, total force airmen. So it's almost about half the total force active and reserve population. And then, you know, if you look at what we're doing around the world, our Air Force is just everywhere. We got about 27,000 people deployed across the Air Force, and 10,000 of them are A4 people. So we're involved, we're engaged, and we just got so much going on. And I look forward to taking your questions. I have a couple prepared comments here, but I'm really looking forward to taking the questions. I'm going to focus my comments really on the logistics piece, the weapon system sustainment, manpower, and logistics piece, but certainly love to take questions, anything engineering, anything force protection, as we go forward. So if I were to give you a state of the Air Force A4, state of what's going on, I would categorize it in three major areas, and that's tempo, manpower, and aircraft condition. The tempo, I mean, many of you already know what's going on with our Air Force. You see it every day. We're deployed all over the world. We're engaged everywhere in the supply chain management and providing the resources, protection, and engineering to across the Air Force. But we suffer the same maladies that everybody else would, and as many of you did before, some retirees in the audience. I have 27 years of combat operations, flying our airplanes, operating our space systems, and now introducing cyber and new systems for 27 years. So we have an entire generation up through colonel that know nothing but combat operations, and we're really the world's best. Now, when I grew up, it wasn't that way, right? I teach the wing commanders down, and I open up the senior leader maintenance course, mission generation course at Maxwell for the wing commanders every year. And I start out with a bunch of new stuff, and right in the center of it is a map. And I have blocked out all the words on the map, and I said, can anybody just tell me what that map is? And it's about six courses a year, and two of the courses people knew, a person knew, and four of the courses nobody knew. And I said, for the first 47 years of our Air Force, that's all we cared about. That's the fold a gap, children. And nobody, I mean, they just didn't know. And my point to them is, hey, we're heading back to the fold a gap, right? I mean, just if you look at where we need to go in the future, we need to concentrate, yes, on where we are in the area of responsibility, but we got a lot of engagement in the Pacific, a lot of engagement in Europe, and we got to focus our efforts on the new future and where we're heading. So, but we suffer those same maladies of deployment, of aging aircraft, and of budgets, frankly. You know, we've lost 38% of our end strength since Desert Storm. We're down about 38%. When we went into Desert Storm, we had 134 fighter squadrons. Now we have 55 fighter squadrons. We're as deployed really now as we have been ever in terms of percentage and where we're going. And in fact, we thought we'd be home in 2017, which is good for the A4 people. We're, you know, the sustainers, like, we don't mind slowing down on the tempo, but the tempo in fact is picking up. So we're expanding instead of contracting, and we're looking for new ways to support the operator on the front lines, and the front lines is an ever-expanding location of those front lines. We're in places not in the not only in the AOR, but theater security packages, both in the Pacific and in Europe, as well as engagements all over the place. So that's tempo. I think everybody here knows we're busy. Somebody called us we're busy as a one-armed paper hanger not that long ago. I like that. I wrote that one down. So our tempo is really, really something else. The second thing I want to, bring up is and share with you is our manpower. So we've been short maintenance manpower for a number of years now. I've been really the lead advocate in our air staff trying to generate the Air Force towards supplying more maintenance manpower so we can generate more air power, because the number one problem we have in our Air Force, in my opinion, is pilot production. We're short pilots. We need to get the pilots the sorties they need particularly in the fighter business, the sorties they need so that they can be the world's best. I don't think we're giving them enough sorties. So we had a number of things working against us. One is manpower. I started this journey about 3.5 years ago. We were 4,000 maintainers short of what we needed. And that hole was growing by 40 maintainers every month because as we were bringing in F-35s, and F-35 requires 20 maintainers each to maintain. We were bringing two per month in. So the hole was getting bigger. Well, our Air Force is committed to fix that. We recognize the problem. In fact, in 2016, without any budget enhancements or improvements or anything, our chief and secretary chose to move critical accession manpower from other very critical needs in our Air Force to maintenance. So we were able to shave that down. We're now 3,400 short maintainers, and we're planning it. We will get that number down to zero by about 2020, 2021, which I'm very happy about. But that's almost like squeezing the balloon. And what happens on the other end? Well, now we're going to have a lot of inexperienced workforce. So we're going to have many recently graduated high school students working on our fighter airplanes. And we take that very seriously, that we get them trained correctly so that they're trained and become experts eventually in fighting it. I was at I was talking recently with the 82nd Training Wing Commander. That's at Shepherd Air Force Base, and Moon Daugherty. And Moon shared with me that last year he trained 2,400 maintainers, and this year he's training 4,800 maintainers. So about a 2x in the training pipeline. So we're committed, but like I said, we're solving the quantity problem for manpower, but we're gonna. We're going to have to work on the quality problem, and that's getting the experience for those manpower. Excuse me, I'm fighting a cold, so if I cough here, please pardon me. One area that we're also working to keep up with F-35 is we're so short on this manpower, this 3,500, and we're standing up units. We just stood uphill in IOC in 2016. Very proud of that as an Air Force. We still can't keep up with the quality. We can bring in a lot of accessions, but that's apprentice maintainers. We need quality skilled maintainers. So we, in 2016, and then we began, and in 2017, we'll be manning five of our field training units with contract maintenance and harvesting that experienced maintainers and moving those towards the fighter airplanes that we need. And I'll get back to that in a little bit as I share some more thoughts with you about the contract aspect of that. But so manpower, yes, we've solved it, or we're solving it. But we've solved the numbers issue. Now we got to work on the quality issue, and we'll continue to juggle that issue around as KC-46 comes up. We're looking not at the same problem, but we think we have a good plan for KC-46, but we have to stick with our plan. The third area that I'd like to discuss with you is aircraft condition, and I'll tell you, when we started this fight. 27 years ago when we started our deployment, our 17 years ago, our airplanes were average 6 years. Now they're 27 years on average. And that, we hear that a lot, at least I hear that a lot. I don't know if you read that a lot when you're out and reading in the press or whatever. And that just kind of rolls off your tongue. It does, but it doesn't really tell as the guy responsible for sustaining these airplanes. That doesn't tell the whole story in my mind. Any F-16 pilots in here? Former F-16 pilots? Okay, so former F-16 pilots. So I grew up in fighters and bombers. When I was a captain, we worked on F-16s in Europe. And we didn't even know the wings came off the airplane, right? If we ran a generation, we'd run out of pilots before we ran out of airplanes because the airplanes were so good that the pilot fatigue, and you know, we'd use too many pilots, we have to stop flying. That was when I was a lieutenant. When I was a brigadier general running the depot at Hill Air Force Base, we began to explore taking the wings off the F-16s because of corrosion issues, and we had to understand how to get them off, and we did validation and verification to get the wings off, put them back on. Very complicated effort. Since then, we've changed 550 wings in the field for F-16s. It's just the nature of the business. The KC-135s, they set at the depot, just out of depot this week on Monday. The artisans out at Tinker Air Force Base, very proud of them. General Mark Johnson's running a really tight ship out there. They set their record. Completed depot maintenance program, depot maintenance on the KC-135 for 71 aircraft last year. 90% of those airplanes had major structural damage when they took the skins off. So, and then they had to repair them, right? 90%. And that's some people kind of raise their eyebrow and say, wow, that's kind of, are you sure you want to fly those airplanes? Well, we are the best. We're the world's best at sustaining airplanes. So those airplanes are very safe. We'll run those airplanes till the KC-46s are in are available for work. But my only point to you is when you're doing all that maintenance, the airplane's not flying. So we're not training our pilots. I was out at B-52s, and no kidding, the B-52 line on Monday, and the landing gear, if there's any B-52 pilots, you know, seven miracles have to happen simultaneously to get those wheels back in the airplane, you know, on this 1960s airplane. But the structure, the A-frame structure that holds the landing gear in place, they're up there with a buzzsaw, you know, cutting it out because they're cracked and they got to replace the entire internal A-frame structure in the center of the B-52. It's just an amazing work. And it'll go right back in and it'll fly, and we'll fly those airplanes. We're looking to get 90 to 100 years out of that airplane. Amazing. We're the world's best at sustaining airplanes. We're looking to get if our plan goes accordingly, we'll get about 30,000 hours out of our F-15Es designed for 8,000 hours. And we'll do that through scientific research, detailed engineering, inspections, and repair and replace along the way. We're the world's best at it. But again, when that F-15 is in mod or that F-16 is getting the wing off, it's not flying, that pilot's not getting trained. So that's really a challenge for us, and one I want to just kind of throw out to the to you that, you know, can we find better ways to maintain these airplanes? Is there a better way to predict the condition of the airplane? You know, we have a pretty comprehensive flight structural fatigue program, but is there a better way? Is there some new technology that can help us? Is there some new repair processes? You know, we're very interested in stuff like cold spray and stuff like 3D printing. I have a Twitter account. I don't really operate it too much, my exec does. But we just posted it on. I was out at Tinker, and the artisan's holding up a dashboard for B-1 that he 3D printed. They're gonna install it on a B-1. You know, that kind of stuff is we're lagging industry right now. We want to get up at either partner with or get ahead of industry as we look forward. So that's a big challenge for us. So when I look to the future, what am I looking at? So we got to find ways to increase aircraft availability to get those pilots the sorties they need. And we got to drive down budget too. So I was talking to a couple of folks here about the budget woes. When you have a constrained budget like we do in our Air Force, the place you look is sustainment, because it's big dollars. I said earlier we're about $30 billion annual. You can't avoid looking in a place like that to look for savings, and so you can apply it against mission areas or other critical areas for our Air Force. So I'm challenged to continue keep that AA up, that aircraft availability up, and get the dollars down. So what have we done over the last few years? We've been teaming with industry, and I'd say we have some really we have some great examples of where industry and the Air Force come together to sustain an airplane. I mean, F-22, C-17, F-35, KC-46. KC-46 is a great example, I think, of how industry and the Air Force is combining efforts. We all know that we have strengths, core strengths. You know, I believe that the Air Force is part of our core strength is our touch labor. Another part of our core strength is like our organic supply. Industry's great at engineering, industry's great at supply. Can we get to some place where we can we get further than we are today? You know, at Depot, we use the Depot in the Air Force Sustainment Center. these vehicles called captains of industry contracts. And these captains of industry contracts are contracts that are kind of leveraged with industry to have a vehicle already established so you can rapidly, if you have a problem, like you got to cut a landing gear out of a B-52, you have the technical means to get a company to help you rapidly rather than waiting in 2 year of contract action to try to get that repaired. Where can we go? We use that similar. I referred to the maintenance for at the field level at the FTUs that we're manning. We used a similar contract vehicle to do that. That's why we were able to affect those hiring actions at the field level using contract maintenance really rapidly inside of a year. The only way we were able to do that is to have some type of leverage contract with industry already set up that we could use. So how can we get together? Is there other places we can get together? I mean, I challenge you to think about that. I mean, I've talked to a number of people even this morning about information technology, IT. IT in my world is a dinosaur. The 15 largest systems that operate our supply chain operate on COBOL. Does anybody know? You guys know what COBOL is. I know this crowd knows, but when I talk at home, you know, in the building, all the majors and lieutenant colonels need to go to the history books to see what COBOL is. We got to change that, and we have a great plan to do that. We're working with industry on a number of issues. That's one area where, you know, formerly defense was leading that effort. Anymore, I mean, industry's leading that effort. There's stuff on the shelf. You know, I've told my team, I don't care if it says afloat operations or in ashore operations or in garrison in a field, I'll take it and we'll use it unchanged because we don't need to change it to Air Force Base, or we'll just use ashore ops and say that means Air Force Base. You know what I'm saying? We don't need to change the IT that's already working. We're looking for that opportunity to do that. Where can we do? Is there other opportunities in services? We have plenty of services. A lot of our money is spent on services. Where can we partner with industry? That's where I spend a lot of my time thinking. I think I'll stop there and just share with you as I come down to take questions that as we look forward, we have a strategy that's built. I'd love to share it with anybody that's interested. I'm using words, and our tribe is using words like pre-supply instead of resupply. We see a future where, in a contested and denied environment, the tail is not the tail. Mr. Estevez used a great line, Alan Estevez, and I'm using it. Sustainment and logistics is not the tail; it's the jaw that enables the bite. If we're in a contested, denied environment, we're not going to be able to. We don't think we're going to be able to set up big bases forward, like, you know, this desert storm and setting up those kind of things. That's just not the future. The future is going to be almost, I equate it to a two-minute drill, right? Two-minute drill, they have three plays already set. So, hey, go to that island. When you're done with that island, go to that country. When you're done with that country, go to that country one day. And we're going to start moving supplies around to catch up with you. Pre-supply. How can we get there? A man can dream right now. I'm not going to get there on COBOL, I can tell you that. But a man can dream. And I think that with latest kind of technologies and innovation, we can make things happen. So I'll stop there, and I'll look forward to questions from the audience. Thank you.
Rizik, General Dynamics. I was wondering if you could share with us your thoughts on sort of the top three challenges we're facing with Air Force security forces, mm-hmm. particularly given with respect to high consequence assets. I'd be curious to get your views on that.
I would say right now, Chattanooga, you know, when they say high consequence, I think airmen, okay, our people. But I'll get to other high consequence assets in a minute. Chattanooga, really, we don't even say it, we just say Chattanooga, and everybody on my staff understands that, you know, the Chattanooga attack about a year ago. We've been, um, we, have been asked, our chief asked me to said, how do we figure out how to get to better protecting our airmen and their families? So we set up three programs on the base, basically set up a concept so an airman can arm themselves with their personal weapon until they get to the office, the work site. And from there, at the work site, on the base, the government will make it more secure. So we enacted set up three programs. One was staff arming, so the defender's in a security forces building right now. The guy working in the armory is already armed, so there's a rapid response force already armed. They don't need to go issue weapons and so forth. I mean, they're ready to go, in addition to the people that are on patrol. That was one issue. Congress gave us legislation, I think 2008, called the Law Enforcement Officer Safety Act, which allowed credentialed defenders to carry concealed weapons on base. That was and the Air Force used it. We actually paid for our airmen to get the credential, but we didn't enforce it. We kicked that in after Chattanooga, which was really good. And then if you were to walk into an Air Force base, an office today, and you walk up, you know, the third floor, you might see somebody sitting there doing their email armed, unit marshal program. So a blocking force. So if somebody comes into an office that's going to do something just stupid, a blue can shoot back and basically block until the force get there. So we did that. We also, I'm very excited about emergency mass notification. I mean, you know, you see that child alert when a child, what do you call that? When the baby gets Amber, thank you. Amber alert, you know, something like that. We challenge ourselves, like, can't we get an Amber alert type thing on cell phones? It was this funny, right? In the NCR, the Navy had a program, the Army had a program, the Air Force had a program, Marines had a program. That was available, but not everybody had it. So literally, if something happened on Bowling Air Force Base, I could be driving to the BX from my house, and all the sailors would be jumping in a ditch, and I'd be driving right into the fire, you know? We got that all fixed. So right now, any command post in the National Capital Region, any command post pushes a button and every military gets notified immediately. I got notified last night. There was a bomb alert. Did you get it? A couple of airmen might have got it on their cell phone. Mass notification, very, very important. We're going to have the whole, before the end of this year, I think in the next 3 months, but well, I'll say by the end of the year, the whole Air Force will be set up regionally so that, because right, even today, if you go to a base like, say, Hill Air Force Base, where you have AFMC and you have ACC, those are two different command posts, but they're the same Air Force. One person should push a button, everybody should get notified. That'll be done here within the next couple months. So we're excited about that, people. So that's the people thing. Technologies, I get concerned about the security of our assets because technology's kind of taken over, you know. You see it all the time. In fact, they had an article during the or a little expose during the presidential inauguration about how they're addressing unmanned aerial systems flying around. We're addressing that in the Air Force, everywhere we are. Very important to us and new. You know, most people would say just shoot it down. Well, I think the FAA would tend to disagree. We're in the continental United States, so we have to worry about people's property. It could be unintentionally written in. So we're working through all those rules now as a department to figure it out. I'd say that's the big one.
Yes, sir.
Hi, Scott Massioni with Federal News Radio. I was wondering, you talked about maintainers. How many right now are you putting under contract, and how much more expensive is that than actually having ones that are within the service?
I don't have a number for you. We're doing it at six bases. It's roughly a one for one. It's actually a little less than one for one with the contractor, because what we've asked for is a service. Hey, make sure you can get X amount of sorties, and they man to what they need. So it could be more. Could be less. I don't know. The dollar value is about equal. If you look at we're going to take the airmen and we're going to replace it with money for contractors, but the dollar value is about equal. But I didn't say it in my comments, and I want to make sure you understand it's a short-term plan. So we only have that out for about, once we get the manpower solved in 19 or 20, we're going to bring the military back. And in fact, we kept the manpower bill that's on the books that we'll carry until we can get our inventory up.
Yes, sir. Mm-hmm. Hi, David Isby, Air International Magazine. We have the FY 2017 supplemental coming up and an accelerated review before the FY 2018 request goes in. What are you looking for in terms of additional resources for readiness and your responsibility areas?
Mm-hmm. In our previous budgets, we've taken a lot of risk in our installation. So we've taken our precious resources and we've applied them to mission needs. And we've taken risk in the base support area. So we have one of our supplementals, we have a number of supplemental initiatives. One of them is to increase the requirements for funds to secure to maintain our bases. But I will also tell you, I mean, we feel if you just look at the number of airplanes, number of airmen, and number of bases, we don't need all the bases that we have. We have more infrastructure, more capacity than we need, so we can come down some. And we're willing to do that, and we're willing to study that. That's a big one. Stuff like supplies, transportation, funding, all that is being inserted into our unfunded priority, and it will compete with other needs.
Yeah, hi, James Drew from Aviation Week. Mm-hmm. With the contractor support for maintaining the F-35s, how does that compare to having to get these contractors to support these aircraft? How does that compare to legacy aircraft like the F-16 and F-15 when they rolled out? And also, how do you plan to get these contractors out to the front lines when these aircraft go into combat?
Mm-hmm.
And secondly, how are you going to protect forward bases like Guam and all your other Pacific bases against cruise missile and ICBM threats?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, thank you. So we're taking the active duty from the units and moving those active duty to F-35. So right now we're using contract in some locations, but they're training locations for F-35. But our intent is not to put contractors in combat units. So we're gonna put the contractors in training units. We're gonna move the active duty to the F-35 some other needs, but mostly F-35, so that when they deploy, the combatants will go forward with the airplane. I think that answers your question. And then the security in the Pacific, Guam was mentioned. There's a number of ways we're looking at further securing the island of Guam. But hey, technology's catching up, right? Even in Libya, when in Odyssey Dawn, so this was how many years ago is this? This was about 6 years ago. We were some number, I don't know the number, but we were like 50% precision, 50% not precision weapons. We're all precision weapons now, as is, and we expect that from our adversaries in the future. So a place like Guam, it eventually will become. Under the umbrella of an adversary's missiles. So what are we doing about it? Well, we're working for active and passive defense. We're looking for new technologies. There's lots of new technologies out there to help us. We're looking for part of my world is how to be more resilient, how to confuse the enemy, and we're taking many actions to do that as well. We're using all that. Anything's on the table for to protect our airmen, to protect American assets abroad.
Hi, Oriana Pollack with Military.com. I was wondering if you could talk a little bit more about munitions sharing between coalition partners in the fight against ISIL and how we're working with precision-guided bombs and how we mitigate how we share these munitions.
Sure. The I mean, we have standing agreements with nations, and nations have standing agreements with us. If a nation were to ask for munitions, we make sure we'll ensure that we have them in quantity where we can afford to share them. We'll also borrow if we need to in that arrangement. So that, I mean, it's a standing process. Does that answer your question?
I know there was a shortage, so is there a ramp up of
war,
or how?
Yeah. We've been dropping weapons quite proficiently for a while now, and we have no problem with our inventory. Okay, so we can continue the fight really indefinitely. We're working with industry now to ramp up their supply chains and their production to get us more right now. We manage it very well in the Air Force. It's centrally managed. It looks across the Air Force, looks across COCOMs to look for how do we get the assets to where they need for the fight that they're at. So I'd say we have no inventory problem, but we do recognize that our inventory is not where it wants to be. I mean, we want to grow, right? So it's incumbent on, I think the industrial base is not large enough. And I also think the department needs to transmit a commitment for a longer term effort, because we're going to be working our munitions inventories for quite a while.
General Wall.
Thank you, Chuck Wall, Deloitte. Can you talk a little bit about ALIS and how that's coming for the sustainment for the JSF, what the current status is, and how you see that fitting into helping you with reducing the cost of sustainment?
Sure. ALIS is coming along. You know, if ALIS was its own program, ALIS would be an ACAT-1 program. I mean, it's that large, so it's not really just the maintenance information system. So it's not just my world, but it really runs the F-35. It's had its burps in the past. It's really starting to get its legs underneath it and be supportive. One of the challenges that I find with ALIS is that it does not connect to the depot operations, and that's where all the supply chain starts. So the repair source for the supply chain is not connected through ALIS, and that bothers me. I think that should be. I don't know. So the F-35 sustainment is a contract, and I'm a vocal customer for the contract. So it is a contract moving towards a performance-based logistics contract, and I'm a customer. So I make my requirements known. I have made that requirement known, and we're working with the Joint Program Office to find a solution.
Mike, you have a question?
Thanks, sir.
Mike Basil with CACI. Thanks, General Cooper, for those great words and all the information here. You talked about aircraft availability. You talked about your sustainment challenges. You talked about the age of the force. You know, from where I come from, cybersecurity is a big issue. And I know it's a threat to some of the aircraft, the systems on board, the support systems. It also adds an expense to something that is probably not in your budget. How are you guys dealing with that?
Thanks, Mike. That's a great question, because I think we've elevated that. We're formerly, I think, it's not just the Air Force, in the department, really everywhere. Cyber was almost considered an admin. Cybersecure was kind of we have to fix cybersecure. No more. Cybersecure is front and center. We recognize that. We've organized our Air Force with 25th and 24th Air Force to have a focused review on that. And we recognize that it's front and center, and we're putting our money where our mouth is. So I think our future budgets will show cybersecure integral. Not maybe it won't be a separate add-on. It'll be integral into the programs that were cybersecure, which I think is very. I mean, I'm excited about that. But where we're finding all our problems is an usually an industry-supported system that updates the OFP. Or the codes with a laptop that's in an insecure fashion. We got to get past that. So a lot of the stuff we bought over the last 10 years is updated. I mean, munitions are up. You plug your computer into the munition casket to update the munition. those updates are taken off the worldwide internet, right? So it's not off a secure system necessarily. So what can we do as a team to help so that there's not an intrusion, an unintentional intrusion? I'm not suggesting that it comes from a contract, but it's just unintentional. How do we secure that piece of the business? Because they are out there, right? I mean, we see that regularly. I think that would help us.
Chris, you have a question?
Chris Jones, Northrop Grumman. Along those lines, if we think about trusted systems and resiliency in new systems, making sure, as you mentioned, they tie into the existing Air Force networks, or driving down availability, there's always been a push to have more of that in the initial requirements, and leading towards open system architecture, so that way rapid upgrades can be made. And there's always been a struggle with getting that in requirements, so that would drive the contractors in the room to build that in versus expend more of the energy and time and really cost and capability, and then you dealing with the tail aspect of that. Right. So I'd like to get your comments on how that's going, and is there things we can do here in industry on the sustainment logistics support side to support that initiative?
Sure, thanks. Appreciate that, Dr. Jones. There is some things that can go on. I mean, I'm pretty happy with where we're going with a couple of our new major weapon systems and the ones that are on the horizon, because we changed our way of thinking about 4 years ago, and it's actually starting to stick now. So we changed our policy 3-4 years ago, where we added sustainment into the early decisions for life cycle management when we're buying a weapon system. So KC-46 is a good example. The B-21 is going to be a good example. And the ones that we're competing now in there is driving down sustainment costs. Stuff like, I'll tell you, one-offs, don't, the Air Force does not like one-offs. So when I say one-offs, I'm not talking about sexy things like a radar for the airplane. I'm talking about inglorious things like test equipment. We spend a lot of money on test equipment, and I do not need another piece of test equipment for a new munitions to hang on an F-16 or an F-35. I need the same thing your company's building now, just modify it so it can work on that munition. I got way too much test equipment out there. I mean, this is where all the money is in weapon systems. Everybody knows, it's one-offs. It's a one-off on stuff like test equipment. It's one-offs on stuff like IT and management information systems. If a company has a management information system and we're doing business with the Air Force, what's most attractive to me, and I ask the question every time now, is why can't you use that system on this system and just change your ones and zeros to make it work? Companies are listening, so that's good. But the one-offs is you can drive quite a bill on the sustainment side that really goes unseen until we're trying to sustain it down the road. Access to data is critical, and I think that I don't know that we need to own it. It depends on the PEO that's building the contract, but I know that we need to have access to it. We need to have the level of access that we need should we decide to compete it later on. And we form a business arrangement where everybody wins, and we're also able to not lock it in for 50 years. We're able to have to compete it and keep that data. But you have to have access to the indicative data that drives the systems.
I think we're at the top of one more. Thank you.
Thank you, General Cooper.
Yeah.
Bob Garcia with Raytheon. I was wondering if you could speak a little bit about the application of prognostics health management technologies and leveraging big data, machine learning, those kind of applications, and how that's impacting both legacy and new platforms.
We are leveraging that. I'm focusing on internal to the to logistics. I'm focused on logistics IT, certainly. I got to tell you, I feel like I got great support in the building. Our former undersecretary, now acting secretary, is championing logistics information technology. She sees that it needs to improve and go forward. So we've had a number of studies, and we have a new governance that's running it. Very excited about that. And we're leveraging things like, and I mentioned it on the podium, but if it's already built, we don't need something different. If it's working in industry, so we're looking at things like IT that's managing food chains, can they manage our base supply? Okay, things like that. And where I would say formerly senior staff, senior officials in the Air Force didn't understand or recognize the way that new technologies work in our, my vice chief of staff just sent me an article this morning, or yesterday morning, about how an IT system beat the three poker players in Texas Hold'em. I don't know, did anybody see that? It's the first application where a computer outthought humans. It's not a, or chess and checkers is a ABC game. You can program it. You had to, in Texas Hold'em, you have to bluff, you have to hide. The computer is able to do that now, cognitively. He's saying, hey, Coop, I want some of that. Okay, boss, let me get off the COBOL, I'll get back with you. My point is, he's senior leader with vision saying, go faster, and that's what we want to do. Cognitive is the way to, is the future.
All right, General Cooper, thank you so much for coming on. We really enjoyed your comments.
Yes, sir. Thank you very much. Yes, sir.
I'd like to present you with a coveted,
wow,
very large.
That's a coin. Yeah. thank you very so much. Yes, sir. Thank you.
Hey, again, thank you all for being here. We really appreciate your attendance and your support of the Air Force Association. We look forward to the breakfast next month, so please stay tuned to your email as we announce the speaker. I'm told that the arm downstairs in the parking lot will be up so you can get out very rapidly. So again, thank you so much for joining us, and we'll see you again next month. Thank you so much.